Welcome back. Our next talk is given by Marcel Bastiansen from Breda University of Applied Sciences and Tilburg University. And the title, you can already see it there, Concerted Action in the Brain's Language Network, Unification or Prediction is the question.
Okay, thank you very much, Angela, for introducing me. And thank you very much to the organization of this very, very interesting meeting so far. I remember that I organized a similar workshop a long time ago, 2005, 2006, I believe. And at that time, we had a really hard time putting together more than 10 people that were actively publishing in the field of language and oscillations. And if I look at the community that we have now, I'm very happy that this is a really, really, well, fastly developing, fastly growing field. So that's very good. As announced, I'm currently at Breda University, Tilburg University, which are small universities close to my hometown. Most of the work I've been doing that I'm presenting here today, I've been doing in my time in Nijmegen at the Max Planck Institute and Donders Institute. So credits to those as well. And before I forget, thanks to a lot of people that over the years have helped me in learning how to analyze my data and how to set up my experiments and having taught me about psycholinguistics in general. With a special attention perhaps to my most recent PhD student who just defended his thesis 2 weeks ago and has moved away, and I really miss him very badly. And much of what I'm be talking about towards the end of my talk is work that is inspired by him, actually, and also carried out by him. Note that this is the same Lin Wang as Oda was talking about, but this picture is like taken 7 years before the picture that Oda showed, and she's pretty well, much westernized since. Let me warn you that I'm approaching things much more from a functional perspective than the talks we've seen this morning by Pascal, for instance, and the talks we've seen yesterday also. Let me start drawing a very, very general, cognitive framework for language comprehension, which is so general that it's very hard to disagree with it. Which states that in order to comprehend language, you have to retrieve information from memory, and then you have to combine that information into meaningful units. And this view is shared from different backgrounds. My talk was too long, so I had to kick out at least 20 slides, and then David gave me the tip, just kick out the first 10 slides, because you don't need them anyways. So that's what I did. So I'm diving headfirst into unification operations. Which, as a oldish by now processing model from Jeckendorf postulates should take place at least three different levels, at a phonological level, a syntactic level, and a semantic or conceptual level. And as you have your sentence samples, you can construct representations at these three levels, and there has to be crosstalk across those levels. And I had this slide in mind when I went through the talks yesterday to see that much of what we saw yesterday in the morning session was about, let's say, encoding the speech signal, and then in the afternoon session it was more about syntactic structures and how that affects language comprehension. What I will be mostly zooming into is to the syntactic and the conceptual or semantic unification part. Having sketched this very, very broad cognitive architecture of language comprehension, the question then becomes, what is the neural architecture of it, and can we map those two onto each other? And this is perhaps a bit of an old slide. I should perhaps replace it by something newer, but this is a meta-analysis done by Peter Inderfry, one of my former colleagues at the MPI, of a lot of pattern fMRI studies into syntactic processing during language comprehension, and there are very consistently there areas in the left inferior frontal cortex and in temporal cortex that are being activated And by and large, and this is an addition later on by other people, it seems to be the case that syntactic information is combined into larger units, predominantly by LIFG, whereas the retrieval of syntactic information at the word level is predominantly carried out within temporal cortex. Now, these findings and other findings have led Peter Hagwart to come up with this MUC model, memory unification control model of language comprehension, where memory retrieval primarily resides in temporal cortex, unification in inferior frontal cortex, and there's some more loosely defined control components which should sit in, I think, medial frontal areas. Then subsequent studies have very, let's say, carved out in very nice detail the functional anatomy of this network. So we have a pretty good view on, let's say, the structure of the brain's language network. At the same time, it also gives a pretty static view on things, right? And it always reminds me of if you want to understand a piece of music, this is kind of a list of the instruments that constitute the orchestra. And what you really want to know is what are the melodies that are being played by this orchestra, right? So what's lacking in these kind of models that are very much inspired by neuroimaging methodology is the dynamics that through it that operate in this network. So that has been the focus of my research of the past, 10 years, 15 years or so. And so what I've been doing is to look at power changes, most notably during all kinds of syntactic and semantic manipulations at the sentence level. So, focusing on unification, LIFG is the putative area where things are being unified. But if you look at anatomical studies, then there appears to be some gradient. This is an image that Carl Magnus Peterson made on the basis of a review by Susan Buchheimer, done in, I believe, 2002 or around that time. Where you see that there's a kind of a gradient in LIFG from semantics to syntax to phonology, but at the same time, these areas are very much overlapping, right? So the question is, how is the information that is represented in the same area doing two different things? So how does LIFG unify different things at the same place at the same time, right? And my hunch was that we could look at the dynamics within LIFG to see whether there's something in there that may give us a hint as to what segregates this syntactic and semantic unification. Okay, so to summarize a bunch of studies in one or two slides, the very first thing we did was just look at critical words within a correct sentence context and compare that to critical words that violated the sentence context. And our observation was that we see increases in gamma power after correct words that we didn't observe after semantically violating words. So, you could argue, at least it was our working hypothesis at that time, is that successful semantic unification is accompanied by gamma increases. And if there's a failure to integrate this word into the preceding context, we don't observe gamma increases. Now, these kinds of findings and also similar findings have been reported in a range of studies. The details are not always in agreement with each other. Effects may go up or down depending on the exact manipulations. But every time you do something to the semantics of a sentence, you find effects in the gamma band. That's very consistent across those studies. So it seems to be relatively robust across studies. At the same time, we observed that if we did something to the syntax in a sentence, we saw effects in the beta band. So, for instance, this is a time frequency representation of power. This is MEG data. for a correct sentence, so note the difference in time scale. So this is imaging the entire sentence now. It's a 10, 11 word sentence. Where we see that in this lower beta range, there's a gradual increase in power as the sentence unfolds. Which, if we take that very same sentence and we just randomly shuffle the words around, then we don't observe such an increase in beta power. So if we destroy the syntactic structure, this beta power increase, this ramp-like increase, is disappearing. And what we did subsequently, so this is kind of showing you the same kind of data, where you have theta power that kind of rhythmically goes up and down with each incoming word across the sentence, and then for correct sentences you have this ramp-like increase, which you don't have for the random word order sentences here in green. And here's an intermediate condition, a word category violation, so there's a local syntactic violation somewhere within the sentence, and that somewhere is specified, it's either here, here, so the let's say the extent of the red block here indicates how much violations occurred at that word position in the sentence. And when you see when most violations kick in this word category violation condition, the building up of theta of beta power over the sentence breaks down and gets back to baseline levels. So we have a process that tracks, let's say, syntactic structure building that is not engaged when there's no syntactic structure and that collapses when syntactic structure cannot be built. Similar findings have been reported by ourselves, but also, luckily, also by others. So by and large, there seems to be some functional dissociation between semantic and syntactic information on the basis of, well, frequency coding. So our hypothesis then was spatially overlapping networks operate in parallel, so within this LIFG, at different synchronization frequencies in order to keep syntactic and semantic information separate. However, this involves a lot of generalizations across studies, and so we generalize across imaging modalities, e.g. MEG, across manipulation stimulus sets. The other thing was at that time, the effects of semantic manipulations onto gamma were established only locally, that is in response to one target word in a sentence. And we were curious to see how that behaves across the entire sentence. So we run a large scale with a lot of subjects, a lot of stimulus materials, replication study, where we did semantic and syntactic manipulations within subjects. We used, well, following kind of stimulus materials, we had correct sentences under heavy influence of the strong liquor he drove away. Not a very smart thing to do, but that's what the sentence says. And then in what we call the prose condition, we took that very same sentence but replaced all the nouns, verbs and adjectives, so all the content words basically, by length and frequency matched counterparts. So what we get is a syntactically correct sentence that doesn't make sense at all, right? That's called syntactic prose in psycholinguistics jargon. We created again this random word order condition just by shuffling randomly shuffling all the words within from the correct sentence, right? We had two other conditions that I don't present here for time reasons. And the predictions that we had on the basis of these previous studies and these published data is that if we look at the semantically correct sentences, which is only the core condition here, we would expect to observe larger gamma power around 40 hertz, because that was what we observed in the literature, relative to the two semantically meaningless sentences. And if we look at the syntactically correct sentences, it's this one, but also the prose condition, should then produce larger beta power than this random word order sentence. So, it was a bit tricky to do these kind of very specific replications, because if it doesn't show up, then you don't have a story. So, if we go look at prediction one, contrasting the correct sentences versus the other two sentences, what we see in the data are not very clean. But this is the contrast between the correct and the random word order sentences. And what we see is there's a predominance of 40 hertz differences. If we use a cluster-based permutation statistics, then even with this clustering, we find very lots of scattered things that survive our statistical filtering. But let's say most of the power differences are around 40 hertz. They are not very, very convincing, but given that we had a very specific hypothesis, well, I take it to more or less confirm that hypothesis. And if we compare the correct condition to the syntactic prose condition, then we observe the same effect. It's a bit more clean here, and there seems to be something going on also in the higher gamma range. So data are not very convincing, but, well, somewhat of a check of the hypothesis here. And so for the second prediction, looking at the syntactically correct sentences versus the syntactically violated sentences, so we compare the correct ones and syntactic prose ones to the random word order conditions. We observe a very clear, very strong increase in beta power across the word for the correct sentence, not for the random word order sentences. And even if we take the syntactic prose one as representing the syntactically correct sentence, then we see that very same contrast, although a bit noisier, with the same scalp topography. So, well, I think this part of the data is much more convincing than the gamma semantics part. So, firm check here. So, by and large, I would say, given the very specific hypothesis we had, we can conclude that at least our data are at least in line with the hypothesis that we had, that there are different neural synchronization dynamics for semantic and syntactic unification across the sentence. And that's consistent with the notion of a functional segregation through frequency coding of unification at the sentence level. There is, however, one big thing, and if you looked carefully at the scalp topographies of these beta and gamma findings, you saw that they are quite different from each other. Well, I started out saying this should all come from LIFG. And so one thing to do on my wish list is to re-replicate this once more with MEG and then do proper source localization to see whether these beta and gamma effects indeed end up in LIFG, but I haven't done that yet. So, work to do. Okay, I'm doing good in time. So to wrap this up a bit, we started saying that there's a cognitive architecture of language that in which there's memory retrieval and there's unification, and let's see whether we can map that onto the neural architecture. If we look at the neural architecture from a functional anatomy point of view, we see dissociation between, let's say, temporal areas that are more involved in retrieval and frontal areas that are more involved in unification. And if we look at the dynamics, we also see this split. So some of the slides that I kicked out were discussing my theta in relation to lexical retrieval findings. So I don't present that here today, but it's all published stuff, so you can look it up. But there seems to be a relation, at least in my data and my experiments, between low frequency power in the theta range and that relates to aspects of lexical retrieval. And if we look at high frequency power, we see indications of a relationship with unification. So, in a very loose way, I believe that the neural dynamics add to the functional anatomy data in supporting, let's say, the statement that the neural architecture of language comprehension at least loosely maps onto this very broadly formulated cognitive architecture. Okay, then we wanted to follow this up by looking at whether we could get a better handle on exactly what these gamma findings mean. And just to refresh you, the initial findings, the data I just showed you, at a local target word level, there's gamma increases for correct sentences and not for semantic violations. And if you look across the entire sentence, then gamma power increases for semantically congruent sentences and not for syntactic prose. And these data, and also other data, are in line with actually two kinds of interpretations, or two kinds of, well, aspects of unification. In that sense, unification is a bit of a container concept that needs further unpacking at this stage. One is the integration of the meaning of the current word into the preceding sentence context. So that's an integration account of those gamma findings. Or it could be, and this is all inspired by for instance, a review from Alan Lau and colleagues that was called very nicely Deconstructing the N400. Because the other thing that might be happening is that the lexical retrieval of the upcoming item is facilitated when based on the preceding context, and nobody at that time dared call that prediction, because there was a ban on using the word prediction at that time for some reason. So it was facilitated lexical access based on the previous context, which in my view is nothing very much different from prediction. So there are actually two accounts that could relate to this gamma. So integration of the information into the preceding context, or predictability of the upcoming item on the basis of that preceding context. And we couldn't really dissociate between the two, because almost all manipulations either looked at congruent words, so words that fitted into the sentence context and that were predictable, or items that were not congruent with the preceding sentence context and were unpredictable. So what we were missing here, some kind of intermediate condition that can, well, give us a better handle on the interpretation of these gamma findings. So what we figured is that what we need is a word that fits into the sentence context, but that's not predicted. So what we did, and it's a bit of a similar idea as Oda presented before the coffee break. What we did is we had highly constraining sentences, and we had a target word. So sentences like "that illness can be treated with a new medicine much better." So these are literal translations from Dutch. Medicine being a highly predicted word in the sentence context, and the same sentence, but now with a critical word that does fit semantically into the sentence context, but nobody predicts it. Device in this case. Versus an outright violation. And if you ever think of replicating this study, be prepared, because it took three RAs, I believe, three weeks of full-time work in order to generate these stimulus materials and pre-test them in such a way that it was all nicely controlled. So in close probability tasks, it was confirmed that in the high-close condition, people predicted the target word in 70% of the time. And in the low-close word, these words were never predicted. And if we ask people whether these sentences formed a semantically acceptable sentence, we measured that on a 7-point Likert scale, then semantic acceptability ratings were very high for the high close words, but also very high, statistically just a bit lower, but still very high on a 7-point scale for the low close words, and obviously very low for the violations. So, we have three accounts now, right? We have the integration account, which predicts that, which says that this word gets higher gamma because it's being integrated within in the preceding sentence context. So in that case, it only should only work for the high close words, right? So for the high close words and for the low close words, because this word device can also be integrated into the preceding sentence context. So under an integration account, we would predict higher gamma for the high close and the low close words compared to the semantic violations. And under predictability account, basically only the high close condition yields a word that is predicted at a target word. So we expect high close words to yield larger gamma than the low close words and the semantic violations. And if both things are true, so that our gamma reflects both integration and predictability, then we would expect a parametric decrease across the conditions in this gamma power. Now, this parametric decrease is exactly what we found in the ERP data, in the N400 data, in the first analysis. And then when we looked at the time frequency data, it was pretty clear that only for the high close condition we found a clear increase in gamma activity, exactly where we expected it, spot on, and it was not present in the low close nor in the semantic violation conditions. So, And these are the time courses, which are even more convincing, I believe, with 95% confidence intervals around them. And you see that this is a very robust and long-lived effect that lasts for at least a full second after onset of the target word. So I would say the N400 data are compatible with an integration and predictability account. So N400 likely reflects both aspects of language comprehension. Whereas our gamma findings are only compatible with the predictability account. So there seems to be a functional dissociation here between gamma and N400s, and that gave me really a lot of ammo to convince people that you shouldn't only do ERP analysis, but it's really worth the while to also do time frequency stuff. So this gamma increase is sensitive to predictability only, and so this reminded us of something that that Christoph put forward many years ago, and that he called this match and utilization model. So our idea was that this gamma band neuronal synchronization is a result of a match between predictions and input. So we're currently following this up. I was approached by Christian Fiebach and Jona Sassenhagen, and they have a slightly different account of what these gamma things mean in the sentence context. And they proposed a so-called, and I really liked the term, adversarial collaboration between the two of us. And so what we did is we submitted this registered report to Cortex, which has been accepted now. So our, let's say, our intro and method section has been accepted. We're currently running the study, so a bit of a sidetrack, but I'm very enthusiastic about these kind of initiatives that journals are launching now, because it's a tremendous, let's say, liberation from null results biases and replication efforts. I mean, these are things in which it's really worth your while to see if you can replicate a given finding in the literature because you're sure that you can publish it, right? But that's a bit of a sidetrack. So what we do in this study is we have stimulus materials that consist of a lot of sentences, and we have closed probability ratings for each and every word within that sentence. The hypothesis is very simple. Gamma power should correlate with closed probability. Jona has a poster on this that's up there, I believe, tomorrow in the poster session. So please go to his poster because it's really... we have very, very, very preliminary findings, but he'll give you much more background and framing behind this particular study. Okay. Then, this is something I was worried about because Nancy is talking after me, and she told me on the very first evening of this meeting that we should forget about predictive coding. So I'm putting up this slide anyway, so that I'm a willing victim for your talk, Nancy. Since we were thinking about prediction and gamma and predictability, then we entered into this predictive coding literature, which I don't need to explain to you guys here, where there's top-down predictions and bottom-up prediction errors. And there's a bunch of studies from Pascal's lab and also other people that very convincingly demonstrate that these top-down predictions are mostly carried by beta frequencies, while these bottom-up prediction or prediction errors are mostly carried by gamma. And I very shamelessly borrow this model to see whether I can apply it to a language comprehension context. And so this was an initiative of my PhD student, Ashley Lewis, who was really very ambitious in this and really wanted to track down every single study and see whether he could fit a model onto the entire pattern of data that has been published in the literature on gamma, beta, and language comprehension. So he came up with this model where we have kind of an input layer that provides sensory input about the language, and there's a word level representation and a sentence or clause level representation, and there's a higher or highest level representation that codes for the message level representation of what a particular speaker or writer wants to convey. And the idea is that there are representation nodes and there are error nodes at each level. and these representation nodes get input from the lower layer error nodes. They kind of negotiate whether there's a match between the top-down predictions and the bottom-up input within this node, right? Or within this layer, sorry. And so it's not a very elegant model in that sense, because it requires all kinds of double representations. And also we needed to postulate two different gammas, stating that this negotiation or this matching of the bottom-up and top-down info within a layer is being performed by low to mid-gamma, whereas the, let's say, feed-forward or let's say, sending up the prediction errors to higher levels is being performed by high-gamma. So it's not a very elegant model, and it's not very parsimonious, and I'm not very happy about it. But at the same time, it does account for the existing body of the literature, at least even slightly better than this unification of syntactic and semantic information framework. So I'm very much open to criticism to this model and ways to improve this. But for now, it does seem to account for most of the data. And Ashley very carefully went through every published study and compared it, saw whether that could be, let's say, accounted for by this unification hypothesis or by this maintenance and prediction hypothesis. And well, they're more or less on an equal par. So then I'm an experimental psychologist. Then I think we should go for critical experiments. How much time do I have left? Am I, no? Still roughly okay? Okay, I need two, three minutes. So, we have been thinking and also performing one critical experiment, but that's just one, so we need many more. Just to recall exactly what we are comparing here, we are comparing a so-called beta syntax hypothesis that says that beta power increases during syntactic unification and beta power decreases when there's no coherence, when unification fails or is impossible. And we have this beta maintenance hypothesis, so this is this top-down part of the model that says that beta power increases or at least stays at the same level when input is congruent with message level representations, because then you can maintain your current, let's say, cognitive set, whatever that means. And that beta power decreases when you're being surprised by the input, because then you can no longer generate predictions and you have to change your cognitive set or your message level representation. Now, in order to let's say, contrast these two hypotheses, we use an old trick in the psycholinguistics, which is comparing subject-relative sentences to object-relative sentences. And I'll very briefly try to explain that to people that are not familiar with it. So in a sentence, you have a main clause, then you can have a relative clause, which says something about the main clause. So this is literal translation, so in English it looks a bit weird, but in Dutch the sentences are correct. So very briefly, there's a clause final verb here that either agrees in number with the subject of the main clause, in which case it's a subject relative reading, that's the easiest one. So here that means that the father has admired the sons. And or it can agree with the object of the main clause, which is the subject of the relative clause, to complicate things. And in this case, so this is the more difficult reading. It's syntactically correct, but dispreferred in Dutch. In this case, it's the sons that have admired the father, right? So the sense is really opposite. And the third condition was an outright agreement violation where the number here didn't match either the sons or the fathers. So that was just a violation condition. Under this beta maintenance hypothesis, the idea is that if you read this subject relative sentence, then everything proceeds just as you expected, so you can continue to generate predictions. But that's not the case for these object relatives, because at this clause final verb here, you have to recompute a different meaning, the opposite meaning. So we would expect beta increases only for these subject relatives under the beta maintenance hypothesis, whereas under the beta syntax hypothesis, since both sentences are syntactically correct sentences, we would expect increases for the subject and object relative sentences. So what I'm going to show you is time frequency responses to the clause final verbs. And what you very clearly can see, so this is the subject relatives, there's hardly any change in beta power. There's a strong decrease for the object relatives, and there's a strong decrease for the grammatical syntactic violations. I didn't just arbitrarily cut this out. This was based on some kind of localizer that we did, but that's too complicated to explain now. And if we look at the contrast, then it's very plain and clear that we have a very, the familiar beta difference, but now only for the subject relatives compared to the object relatives in this case, and to compare to the violations there with roughly similar sculpt topographies. So the jury's still out. I think we need much, much more data in order to be able to come to a better model and to make this more robust and convince other people besides ourselves that this is a good way to go, perhaps. So we can further refine this maintenance and prediction model or hypothesis. We need more data to differentiate between the unification and this maintenance prediction hypothesis. But for now, I have to say that this maintenance and prediction hypothesis has taken the lead based on the last study that we did. So that's where my contribution ends. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you. Alessandro.
Thanks for the great talk. In your last experiment, if maybe I understood wrongly, but your hypotheses were about what increases or what remains stable. Mm-hmm. But the results that you get, I think, can be attributed to actually a decrease or in the two other conditions mm-hmm. other than the SR. So do you have any hypotheses about this decrease, which is actually causing the effect?
Yeah, I mean the thing is that we don't have a quiet baseline here because we're looking at this word here, right? So if we would look at things across the entire sentence, then we see the usual increase across the sentence. And as you remember, you have these phasic beta responses in response to each word. So I don't know exactly where our baseline will end up. So I think the relevant information lies in the comparison between the two conditions and not in the absolute, let's say, increase or decrease relative to this very arbitrarily chosen baseline period, which is during the sentence, right? And so I think we should really look at the comparison between conditions. That's the most relevant bit.
The next one is Mars, I think.
Thanks for the Lewis and Bastiansen framework. Actually, I really like the fact that someone's translating the N4 literature to the time frequency domain. I think that's really, it's Ashley's future research project for his life. Yeah. So. But I think this idea about syntactic predictions that you have, I have a hard time reconciling it with the data on the N400, basically. And I'm thinking especially on the Frank Brain and Language paper, where he looked at correlations between the n-gram predictability measures and the canonical language earpiece, the N4, the LAN. I think he even has the Elan in there and so on. And the only component that he finds correlated is the N4. He doesn't find a correlation for the LAN, for the n-gram prediction, right? And that would be the kind of family of components that you would want to see for these kind of syntactic style violations, right? And I always had the same feeling when I was reading the Lewis paper. I think the valuable data is very much in line with the N4 style paradigms in beta gamma, but for syntax, it's kind of, I think the strength of the claim kind of bothers me there a little.
Yeah. I'm not sure, but this idea from Stefan Frank for n-grams, that's more for semantic predictions, right? Not really for syntactic predictions. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So in that sense, it's pretty in a way similar to the things we're doing now with the feedback lab, where we use close probabilities instead of those surprisal values that Frank is talking about. But I really would like to involve him in that study also to see whether with his approach we get similar results.
Um, Lynn and you reported that the N4 correlates with the beta band, right? And that's what we should do.
We have reported that in one study and doesn't fit the story, and it's one study, so...
No, I think it really fits the study, because N4, kind of semantic, n-gram-based prediction error, beta band correlated, check. That's totally in line with what you're saying about kind of semantic predictions. But for the syntax side, you know, no one has shown that the beta band is correlated with any of the early negativities or the late positivities. You know, that hasn't been shown. And same for the n-gram. So that kind of, there's something missing there for the story, for syntax.
Okay. So you would...
You need to
specifically look for correlations between early syntax ERP components
and the beta band. If you can show that the LAN or the P6 correlates with the beta band part-time course, then I think this would be much more convincing. And then you can transfer it to syntax.
Yeah. Okay.
It's kind of the missing link for me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Interesting suggestion. Yeah.
Okay. Annelies.
Thanks for the talk. I was wondering whether the gamma activity that you get in your semantic prediction experiment could be caused by beta, given what Pascal presented earlier this morning. I think this could be possible in the sense that beta could be focally generated and actually causing something that is more powerful, widespread, whatever. So would your data set be compatible with this? Can you test it?
Well, at that time we didn't clearly look at beta because we were very much focused on this gamma idea. But given this maintenance and prediction framework, we would expect for the predictable conditions to have a clear view on the reflection of prediction in the beta frequencies, together with an increase in gamma that reflects the successful match, right? So we would expect both phenomena to be there. So either we have to do a new experiment or to dive back into those data. But that would be my prediction there. Yeah.
Relevant to that. So Nancy says that she has the answer, so maybe we should wait for this. So I now have...
But I think it's basically what you said.
Yeah. Okay, Lucia.
Thanks, Marcel. I have a maybe a clarification, or just trying to understand, you know, what your beta findings are. What I see in your plots is that it's like a ramping up effect, right? So I'm trying to understand whether the effects really lie in beta, or is a slow oscillation that is modulating beta.
A slow oscillation is modulating beta, so
like a CNB, or you know,
I think
like
the
delta
best view on it is perhaps
more or less like what NICE is, right? So in essence, you know, we are not looking at you know, beta, but in this case, you know, it could be like high gamma or anything. And at the end, what happens is that the higher rhythms are modulated by slower rhythms. So I'm trying to understand where beta is the carrier, or it's just been modulated by a slower oscillation in your account. If you go, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, this one. Yeah. I'm not sure. You see these phasic responses, which you don't see back in the ERP. So this is also really an intrinsic rhythmic modulation here. And on top of that, you see this ramp-like thing, and so there's increasingly more power as the sentence unfolds, and then you can speculate about what it means. But you have to do experiments to try to narrow down the interpretation space, right? So does that answer your question, or?
Well, I mean, the specific question is where you think that the effects are in beta, or just you're just looking, you're unraveling them, but they are a defect of a slower oscillation. So, like, I give you the very simple example. If we look at high gamma, if you look at the envelope of the high gamma, then we see nice effect, right? Mm-hmm. You know, like the delta modulation. So in that case, I wouldn't say that it's high gamma. It's that the high gamma is modulated by a slower oscillation.
But this is pretty clearly confined to the beta frequency range, as you can see here, right? So in these kind of time frequency decompositions, I mean, it's pretty clear what the frequency is that you're finding. And if there would be relationships with other frequencies, that should be apparent in these kind of representations, which is not the case here.
Okay, yeah. I have two more questions, David.
If you can go to the slide where you had the semantic sentences. So I saw there, you know, why didn't you, the time frequency data that you showed, you had the difference between the two in the theta band, and you didn't relate to that.
Here, you mean?
Yeah. Is it the sentences where you played? Yeah. You see, you have theta in the theta range.
Yeah, but this is cut off at 20 hertz, so there's no theta in this,
so this
plot.
Is,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the same there. See.
I think I should have it here. This is focusing on the lower frequency range, because we have different parameters to compute that. So nothing convincingly on theta here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think at this point I got the signal that David will not have another question, but that we are all waiting now for Nancy's talk. But before that, we first, thank you, Marcel.
Thank you.
Thank you.